If that supply of money can be created for the purpose of saving the banks and building up their reserve...
Give it to the people who can deposit it in the banks.
It shows it can be used for more important economic purposes and for development of investment and for expansion in this economy. It is printing money. We've been told for decades, those of us who had a glimmering of social credit in our economics, that you can't print money. It would be terrible. But disastrous for the economy to print money. It leads to inflation. Well, we've printed 375 billion of money. It hasn't produced inflation. Inflation is falling.
Okay. Printing money fights inflation. Only if real inflation was shift B. Remember Argentina? They had 1,000% inflation rate. Then all those provinces, six of them, started printing up all their bond bucks to pay employees, and the central bank decried all these new sources of currency. What would happen to inflation? And inflation went all the way from 1,000% all the way down to 36% a year. Now, if inflation is really too much foreclosure, and there's more money in circulation, and more jobs, and more deals, and more action, and more debt payment, you're going to have less foreclosure. And that's what happens. So, here again, he's pointing out that they've printed $370 billion in new money, gave it to six or eight guys, who've loan sharked out as much as they could, I suppose, but hasn't caused any inflation, shift A.
I'm sorry, in mid-diet time, I don't mean inflation is falling. It has been possible to do that. Now, why can't we do it for more useful purposes?
Like giving some to the people.
Than shoring up the banks. The Americans have done it. Well over $1 trillion.
I know, but it all went straight to the banks, too.
Quantitative easing in the States. The European Bank is now contemplating it. Mr. Draghi casts around for desperate solutions to the stagnation that's hit the Eurozone. And the Japanese, surprisingly, have done it only last week. So if all can do it, if it's been successful here, if it hasn't led to inflation, we should be able to use that for more productive economic purposes.
You know, it's the first time actually we're hearing evidence about how the printing of money leads to less inflation, right? Or all that money didn't cause more inflation, did it?
If
all those new chips.
We create money, quantitative easing.
Chips.
Go on and create more money. Channel it through a national investment bank into productive investment.
Yeah.
Into contracts for house building, new town generation, infrastructure,
yeah.
Massive infrastructure work, then we can stimulate the economy, stimulate growth, and achieve useful purposes, which we haven't been able to achieve. Here's a solution to a lot of the problems that's bedeviled the Labour Party. How do we get investment without private financial initiative and the heavy burden that imposes on the health service, on schools, on all kinds of activities? Well,
get it? Quantitative easing for everybody but the banks. And then the banks can take in all those new deposits.
Why not?
Pretty good, eh?
Quantitative easing, contracts for housing or infrastructure work, which have a payoff point and which produce an investment, which produce
an asset
for the state. So that's my proposal, allocated by the monetary policy, creation policy, committee, which I advocated earlier under the article from Martin Wolf.
Okay, so we've heard a workable social credit solution, quantitative easing for the poor.
That's, I think, the way we should approach it. That's why I welcome today's debate, because it has to be the beginning of a debate in which we open our minds to the possibilities of managing credit more effectively for the better building of the strength of the British economy.
And no one's there listening. Isn't that a shame?
Thank you, Madam
Deputy Speaker. And I'll speak very briefly. I want to put on record my gratitude, I suppose, to the Honourable Member for Wickham for having initiated this debate and his co-sponsors from various parties. And I must say, having heard his speech, or most of his speech, I apologise for being late, even more satisfied that when I cast my vote for him to join the Treasury Select Committee, it's the right thing to do. Because he's introduced an incredibly important debate, and as has been mentioned already, this is an issue that has not been debated for well over a century. And I think we wouldn't be having this debate if it wasn't for the fact that we are still in the midst of tumultuous times. We had the banking crash, we had the corresponding crash in confidence in the banking system and in the wider economy. And now we have a problem of underlending, partly as a consequence, particularly to small and medium-sized business. So this could not be more important. And the member for I'm going to say my honourable friend, because we work on many issues together for Alderman Warrington, pointed out at the beginning of his speech that this is an issue that is not well understood by members of the public. Well, and I think he was mentioned later on his speech.
Nor the members of Parliament.
This is an issue which is also not well understood by members of this House, by members of Parliament. And I would include myself in that, and I suspect most people here would be humble enough to recognise that this is such a complex issue, this banking wizardry we're discussing today, that very few people really properly understand it. And please.
I thank the Honourable Gentleman, and I totally associate his comments about ignorance, and I include myself in that. But it seems to me that the system is really broken. So there's something very wrong with the system. It is not, you know, if the system isn't broke, don't fix it. The system is broke, and someone's got to fix it.
Call on a banking systems engineer!
Brief remarks, I'm going to come to that. But
the only one!
I was just about to make that if members of Parliament don't really understand how money is created, and I really believe that is the majority
and they're not there finding out
discussions I have been having, how on earth can we be confident that the reforms we brought in over the course of the last few years are going to work, are going to prevent repeat collapse of the sort which we saw before the last election? And my view is that we can't be confident, that it's the impulsive position of ignorant members, and again, I'm not intending to be rude to be, I include myself in that bracket, but the impulse for so many people has been to simply call for more regulation, as if that's going to magic away these problems. But as my honourable friend mentioned, there were 8,000 pages of guidance in relation to one aspect of banking that he discussed in his speech. The problem is not a lack of regulation, it's the fact that the regulations that exist miss the goal in so many respects. And the problem has become so complex, has become so complex, so convoluted, that we need an entirely different approach.
Use poker chips! Not so complex.
And I would say the majority of people outside of Parliament, when you talk to them about banking, have a fairly simple view that the bank takes deposits and then lends, and that's the way it's always been. And of course,
there
is an element of that, but it's so far removed from where we are today that it's only a very tiny element. That most people, or many people at least, understand fractional reserve banking, which we're going to, But I think most people do understand the concept of fractional reserve banking, even if they don't know the term. The idea that banks lend more than they can back up with the reserves they hold.
You mentioned Metro and the
The banks lend more chips than they can back up with the reserves they hold. Not of collateral, of old chips. Get the difference? The loaning out of the new chips isn't based on the collateral that was pledged. It's based on whether there's old chips in the deposit. And when they're gone, they got to call in the chips of a loan, despite the collateral being there. That's how crashes work.
But even fractional reserve banking is just the start of the story. Because as we've heard, and I'm not going to repeat in detail, but banks themselves create money. They do so by making advances, and with every advance they make a deposit. And this is something which I think is so poorly understood by people outside and inside of this house.
New chips!
This is
poorly understood.
Extraordinary power on the banks, and necessarily and naturally and understandably banks will use that power and have used that power in the interests of banks. But it's created extraordinary risk, and the risk, unfortunately, because of the size of the banks and because of the interconnectedness of the banks, the risk is on us, which is why I'm so excited by the challenges that my friend and my honourable friend has just described. But as I said, this is fringe, this is right on the edge. I mean, it's an extraordinary thing to imagine that at the height of the collapse, that for every £1.20, that the banks held just £1.25 for every £100 they had lent out. So we are in a very precarious situation.
Wow, they only had £1 in reserve safety deposit for every £100 in chips they lent out. Oh, they make up a rule that way. You can lend out more chips overall than the reserve. Wow, isn't that horrible? They only had one. They should have had £2 for 100 in volume and chips.
I remember when I was very, very much younger, and I was listening to a discussion and not understanding most of it between my father and various people who were asking his advice. And he was a man who had a pretty good track record in terms of anticipating turbulence in the world's economy. And he was asked, when is the next crash going to happen? He said, the last person you ask is an economist or a businessman. You need to ask a psychiatrist.
If he's talking about Edward Goldsmith, I believe Pauline met him on a UK tour, and he and someone else did an article on Let's, which I have posted at my website. So go look for the Goldsmith article in case it's his dad.
Because so much of it is around confidence, and I think the point...
The guy who had a climate magazine, that Goldsmith.
Was proven just a few years
or
ago.
Or a record.
So the banking system and the wider economy have become extraordinarily unhinged, detached from reality. And I think in a debate at another time, I'd like to elaborate on this extraordinary situation where it is possible to imagine economic growth even as the last of the world's great ecosystems, the last of the great forests, have come down. The economy is no longer linked to the reality of the natural world, which is the world on which all goods eventually derive. But I think that is probably a debate for another time, and I'm not going to dwell on that. But we did have, yes, please, but it's possible to imagine how that might happen. Certainly ecological collapse, but we're talking about the banking system here, and the two are not entirely separate. But we did have a wake-up call just a few years ago, just before the election. My concern is that we haven't actually woken up, that it seems to me that we haven't introduced any significant, meaningful reforms which go to the heart of the problems we're discussing today. It seems to me that we've been tinkering on the edges. And I don't believe Parliament has been as closely involved in that process as Parliament should be. Parliament
no one's there.
That I described at the beginning of my remarks. So I just want to put on the record my support for a meaningful monetary commission of some sort to be established, or an equivalent of, where we are able to actually
study the problem.
The pros and cons of shifting from a factional to something closer to a full reserve banking system, as a number of members have discussed today. This is something we need to understand. What are the
and I want to get rid of the reserve ratio, make it a full let's. Got nothing to do with the safety deposit section.
And I think we need to look at quantitative easing. It's been accepted, I think, by everyone on all sides of the house, that quantitative easing is not objective. There are those who believe it's a good and those who believe it's a bad, but no one believes it's objective. And if there is a majority view that quantitative easing is necessary, then we need to ask the question, why not use those funds, inject those funds into the real economy, into housing, into energy projects, and some of the kind of projects we've heard from the other side, as opposed to using the mechanism in such a way that clearly only benefits very few people within the financial banking wizardry world that we're discussing today. So I think these issues need to be explored, and I think it is time for a monetary commission to be established, and for Parliament then to become much more engaged than we have been. This is a very small step in that direction. I'm very grateful to the sponsors of today's debate. I wish there were more people here today. I was intending to listen, not speak, but there aren't all that many speakers, unfortunately, but it is the beginning, and I hope we'll have many more such debates.
Well, you did your daddy proud showing up at the beginning of the debate on the creation of money and possibly using it for poor people instead of just banks. Okay? You did the Goldsmith family proud. Break. Okay, it would be interesting if the father whom Zach Goldsmith said spoke to him about money creation was Edward Teddy Goldsmith. because Pauline Morissette, my companion in those pre-UN years, had an adventure with Teddy in London while she was there. If I couldn't go to a big event, I could send Pauline. Pauline knew Let's Inside Out, was a charismatic speaker, and would well represent me. So she went, and I made her write reports when she came back. And this was Pauline Morissette's UK Let's Mission Number 2 report. And down here, short blurb, Mr. Edward Teddy Goldsmith, on my birthday, treated me and Sabine to a wonderful meal, including champagne at the Richmond Harvest Vegetarian Restaurant. What delightful company and what a treat. And Sabine Curjo McNeil is my Let's ally in London, who set up my speaking tour engagements over there and was the one who prompted me to apply as the leader of the Abolitionist Party of Canada, who had run for Prime Minister, to go to the United Nations as an NGO. And I did, and I got in, and I got invited to do the speech on the banking system of the future, where I said, well, if Let's local employment trading system works well, why not a United Nations international and local employment trading system, a UNILETS, and that's what they passed in their background documentation. Should have been in the Millennium Declaration, but they struck out the two most important words. Left in the gist, it says, restructure the global financial architecture with an alternative time-based currency. Should have said alternative interest-free, main feature, time-based UNILETS. There was a name given, currency, a Let's for the planet. And now, as all the Let'ses of the world keep growing, they're going to unite someday into a UniLets, whether it means uni, me, person to person, which you can now do, johnturmel.com/UniLets. Uni could mean everybody does their own, or it could mean United Nations, international and local. Double meaning now. So Pauline was on a Let's tour of Britain, and met Edward Goldsmith. And when she got back, she said that after that birthday meal, he'd taken her and Sabine over home, had an evening discussion. Now, you got to understand Pauline. I mean, Pauline was charismatic and funny and comedian. And after 5 minutes with Pauline, you felt like chuckling. And after 10 minutes, you'd been laughing for four. So there is a really good chance that if Zach is the son of Edward, then Teddy may have told him about the Let's lady from Canada, Pauline, he spoke to for an evening, because she has 1,000 funny stories to tell. And at the same time, he gave her a copy of his treatise, a 15-page report on Let's, which was so important, I published it at my site, johnturmel.com/gold, and it's titled New Local Currency Systems by Edward Goldsmith and Perry Walker, July 17, 1995. And it was so great, I typed it all in and I published it, and it's been at my site ever since. So it would be neat if Zach is the son of Edward, who was a Let's fan, right? Okay, back to the debate.